Welcome back around to theCUBE at the NYSE. I'm John Furrier, host of theCUBE. This is part of the Crypto Trailblazers NYSE Wired program and community where we feature the trailblazers in crypto infrastructure, cryptocurrency, the shift in the world of FinTech, DeFi, TradFi. Again, the revolution is happening and the leaders are setting the pace. Jing Wang is here, the CEO and co-founder of OP Labs. Jing, thanks for coming on theCUBE. Appreciate you coming on, the leaders of coming in, and thanks for coming in.
Thanks for having me.
So explain what OP Labs is doing. I know you got the protocol and the software stack. Optimism was the name before OP Labs. Give us a quick overview what you do.
Yeah, we build the infrastructure to enable decentralized computing to be done at scale. So, you know, back in the day when we started, transactions on Ethereum took like 10 to 15 minutes. If it got congested, you could be paying $25+. Oftentimes, the transaction fees required to purchase or send an asset were in excess of the cost of the asset itself. And so we've been trying to solve that problem for the last 7 years.
So I remember 7 years ago, it felt like all the top minds were working on blockchain because it was really, a fun time, right? I mean, it was like all the brightest minds working on it because it's a technical problem, right? And then the ICO craze hit and then the pandemic hit. Then of course the regime change, we all know what happened. Now we're in kind of glory days of, you know, stability with the Genius Act and the Clarity Act, the stable winds come in. So things are clicking, okay? And AI hits, okay? So you got AI hitting about 7 years ago. Now that's 7 years in of like hardcore to actually mainstream. So all bounded by power, okay? So you have a lot. Now you got the challenge of the technology of making it all work. So you have now another fun environment where the best computer scientists, the best algorithms, best problem solvers are working on this. And so now we have more chains, more protocols, but the game is still the same. What apps are gonna run on this? Now smart contracts is a revolution because that's a beautiful thing because it makes everything work and it's stored decentralized. So it's just like the Ethereum is one big computer. So if you think about it as one big computer, you say, oh, what are we gonna process? So take us through some of the things you're working on and what are the challenges, because this is going to bring in an era of innovation. So scope the challenges that you're working on and why you're doing it and your approach to targeting it, because again, once this happens and flips that bit, the next thing happens, which is good. So explain the complexity and some things you're working on, how you're attacking it.
Yeah, well, 7 years ago, the infrastructure was really immature. That was like the biggest problem. And so people who could see beyond the immaturity and see how the infrastructure might evolve over time, those are the people that were the most excited about crypto. But if you're kind of on the outside looking in, you're like, what the fuck is this? This is a cartoon cat being sold for $200,000. I don't understand.
Yeah.
And so the both are reasonable takes. But what we've seen is like each time you mature one increment of the infrastructure, boom, there's a whole explosion of things that happen. Some of them stick, some of them don't. And 99% of those things are just testing out those primitives, whether it's enabling tokenization to happen really simply, so the ERC-20 or the ERC-721, NFTs, so on and so forth. And each time we've lowered transaction fees and the latency of transactions, you've also seen an explosion of new things taking place. So
so the more you solve the problem, the more demand for the infrastructure. We're seeing this play out. I wrote a post about NVIDIA. And again, the inside baseball at NVIDIA is no matter how many Blackwells we make and how many times we connect them with InfiniBand or Ethernet or whatever, and KV cache, they want more. So you fill the void there, and then boom, there's more demand. So this is a beautiful thing, actually. It's innovation cycle. What is the scale challenge? Is it speed, throughput? What is the and what layer is the action at? Can you take us through that for the folks that aren't inside the ropes? Because this trail needs to be blazed right now.
It's all of the above, and all these things are often coupled, and there's always trade-offs. If you want high security and speed, then you're going to have to make a trade-off of cost, potentially. And so it's about continuously lowering the need to make those trade-offs iteratively over time. And we're now sitting at 65% of all L2 transactions running through the OP stack. And we've seen that every single time we make it faster or make it cheaper, block space just, demand just fills back up the available compute that we've created. So it's pretty cool.
So on the scale side, again, scaling laws kind of kick into effect. Is there a mental model or scaling law you like that you use, or is there a way to explain the scaling law? Because you have to ride the wave, but again, the demand's coming in. So what does scale mean for you? I mean, how do you think about scale? Because you, again, they got the trade-offs. I get that. So like from a scale standpoint, I mean, you'd buy a bunch of servers, put them in a rack. On the AI side now, it's the whole data center is a supercomputer. What's the, and now you got the decentralized infrastructure and all kinds of things being enabled. What does scale mean to you? What's the problem statement, I guess? I guess, how would you think about scale and the problem statement of what scale looks like for you? Is it speed, throughput, or a number of nodes?
I would say that everybody always wants to do whatever they're doing more cheaply, mm-hmm. and more quickly. And so it never ends. And the question then is, where do the bottlenecks exist? At what point does the architecture become a bottleneck? At what point does the hardware become a bottleneck? And every use case is different also. So for institutions, we talk about and think about scale a little bit differently than we do for DeFi applications. Because each category performs different actions and cares about different things being cheap.
So the scale is different to different people.
It's different to different
people.
All right,
so talk about the software stack, because we were talking before we came on camera and the podcast around how you got the foundation and you got the for-profit. Explain the difference just quickly. Is it the normal foundation role and then the company, and that's the key secret sauce is the software stack? Is that right? Explain the difference.
The goal of the foundation is to steward the decentralization of the protocol and the token treasury. OP for OP Labs, its mission is to build the underlying technology, the rails. So when you click send on a transaction, everything that is required for that transaction to actually go from person A to person B quickly at low cost, that's the software that's getting written.
And what's the status of the software? How would you put that in the progress bar? You said 60% now.
65% market share for all L2 transactions.
On Ethereum?
Yes.
Okay.
Ethereum L2 transactions. I guess there's always more. Like every time we hit one milestone that we didn't think was possible previously, the progress bar lengthens. Yeah. It changes.
And so what are you working on now? What's the big problem statement that you're focused on now for the stack? Is it that next bottleneck, or what's the next thing that you're targeting?
So Coinbase is probably doing more transactions per day than just about any other application on their chain. They're one of our customers. They're doing about 20 million transactions per day. And as institutions come in, or fintechs, they're regularly doing a lot more than that. Crypto today is incredibly small compared to compared to finance in general. And so it's been really great partnering with Base to push the limits of what the scaling technology is capable of. And now it's just about gearing up to be ready for this next wave of fintech adoption.
So one of the things in the Crypto Trailblazer series that I like is, one, I get to learn a lot more. But I can see some dots that are connecting. One is the financial markets, the traditional institutions. You know, if you go back to 2017, it was like, oh yeah, burn them to the ground. We're going to disrupt everyone. But now there's a collaboration culturally between the two because of the environment we're mm-hmm. in. There's an innovation synergy coming.
Yeah, totally.
But there's still structural change.
Mm-hmm.
And now you have entrepreneurship kicking in, where you're seeing entrepreneurs come in and see those white spaces and saying, look it. I can actually take down a part of the market that someone else had if they don't move fast enough.
Mm.
There's plenty of beachhead.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, I've never seen that before in my career, where in finance, where it was controlled by everyone, that there's actual takedown opportunities for markets. Mm. Now, this has been entrepreneurship hustle. Hey, you know, get some prepaid cards, ride the rails, and, you know, buy a boat. and make money, but not like this. This is like really kind of game-changing, you know, wave. So we're starting to see product management thinking come into the equation, or entrepreneurial, like VC-backed thinking around, hey, I actually could go make $1 billion in this TAM that's huge. Mm-hmm. So you start, and that's a kind of a tech angle, but it's got money involved, but money's just like a packet. It moves from point A to point B. So what's your thoughts on that? What's your reaction? Do you see that? Do you feel that? Do you see examples of friends and colleagues who are like, you know, thinking about this? Because I know the entrepreneurship's high, obviously, but like actually going after the opportunities.
Yeah, totally. The fintechs that we're working with are interested in what we're calling the DeFi mullet. And so they want to be able to offer DeFi level yields and opportunities to their in-app users. And so it's definitely super symbiotic right now with fintechs. And we do a lot of legwork to help fintechs integrate. We're not just infrastructure. We think of ourselves as kind of a one-stop shop because, I mean, we invented optimistic rollups. Like, we've really built a lot of this infrastructure from the ground up. We've been here for a decade. Yeah. And we understand every part of the stack really well. So it's really exciting to see. I don't know, like in crypto, if you hit like 10,000 real users, not bots, that's like crazy, amazing. Yeah, it's not just one guy on 10,000 computers farming your thing. And now we're talking to companies who don't only have 10,000 users, they have 10 million users, and they're thinking about how to seriously integrate crypto into their applications. It's kind of mind-blowing.
It's real. I mean, it makes it real.
Yeah,
I mean,
it's real.
It's real. And again, the impact of society is great. That's why I'm so excited to talk to you about that, because one of the things I've been pro on is, one, it's breaking through the mainstream, and as the mainstream comes in, more trend, like to your point about one block's filled, then another one, the demand is going to be huge. And so again, I'm predicting a tsunami of activity, mm-hmm. real activity, and I'm just trying to squint through that. So, you know, when you look at the success now, what are your challenges? What are you thinking is next for you guys? Because you got great position, and solving a big problem on Ethereum. I mean, gas prices has always been a challenge, throughput. So they're checking those boxes. I mean, Ethereum 2 years ago is not the same Ethereum now. What's on your to-do list now?
Yeah, I mean, we can handle tens of millions of transactions per day on a chain pretty seamlessly on our infrastructure. And so the challenge is, if you have a larger flood of activity, then either transactions slow down or they get more expensive. And our target on a per transaction basis is 1/100th of a cent, which we have today. And so, I mean,
people must love you, by the way. You get a lot of love letters. Hey, thank you so much.
No, we don't.
No? Yeah, okay.
We get a lot of like, hey, where are my tokens? I sent them to this string. Is that right?
Verify.
Yeah, yeah. It's, I mean, again, like the infrastructure is still really immature. Yeah. Like the fact that you visit a website and you know that the 3-line hamburger icon is a menu that you click, like these kinds of intuitions take years to develop for the broader public. And crypto is only at the beginning of developing thousands of intuitions like this to make the crypto experience more intuitive.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And who are your, talk about some of your customers, share some information about the company, some stats, people, metrics, customers.
Yeah. So,
inside the numbers kind of thing, give us and how much money you've raised.
Coinbase, WorldChain. Have you guys heard of WorldChain?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Really cool use case. Sony.
What are they doing?
Kraken. They are tokenizing identities through retinal scanning. It's not as scary as it sounds. They're
sounds
using
cool.
that information that only you can generate, that only you have, to produce an identifier for you that nobody else in the world could steal or produce outside of you.
Complete non-forgible
verification
identity.
Of humanhood. Yeah.
That's great.
And so some of their partners are like Match.com, for example, sites that are now being overrun by bots.
Yeah.
That genuinely need to do this human verification, and they're choosing to partner with World.
It's a great use case.
Great use case.
All right, so Coinbase, WorldCoin, you mentioned Sony.
Sony, Kraken. I mean, there's so many of them. Yeah there's hundreds of OP stack chains out there. Well,
congratulations. That's awesome. Funding? When did you first do a round? Who was involved? What was some of the... Can you share that, or is that private information? No, she's counting. It must be a big number.
Like 390 million? 400 million? Something like that.
It's a good amount.
Yeah. Chunk of change. Over the last 7 years, it's a big chunk of change. Yeah.
And you got revenue coming in from the partnerships. Okay. Yep. So things are going great. Mm-hmm. Awesome. You guys hiring, put a plug in for some of the things you're working on, folks watching.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, please share. People are interested. I mean, there's a whole in migration happening from mainstream.
Can I read off of a list of
the roles we're absolutely. Hiring? Okay. Of course. Yeah. I mean, people want to know.
Okay. Generally good engineers. We you don't need to have Web3 experience. We'll teach you. We have plenty of that. If you're a good problem solver, you can figure it out. We are hiring for a VP of partnerships, a VP of sales, and ICs on the partnerships and sales teams. We're looking for a marketing leader, and we're...
No, continue. It's good. It's great. It's awesome.
Okay.
This is the best part of the video. I'm learning.
All right.
Yeah, continue. It's opportunity.
Yeah. Okay. We're looking for a marketing leader. We're always looking for smart contract engineers. Jobs.optimism.io. Yeah.
Awesome. Jing, thank you so much for coming in. Congratulations. I'm super happy for you and the team. And again, it's the early days, so I'm sure we'll have another conversation, check in. Again, there's a lot of work to do. A lot of smart people are working on us, and we appreciate what you do. And again, you know, we want to get this thing's money flowing.
Totally.
The market's booming. And again, thanks to you and your team. All right, I'm John Furrier here at the NYSC Cube Studios, part of the NYSC Wired and Wired community. Crypto Trailblazers, thanks for watching.